Well, here we are. We just met today. Do you want to start with conversation, yeah. Questions, whatever?
Should I start? I don't even know where to start, David. I just have so much to ask you.
Well, okay, here's something I want to know. It's really for my own personal enjoyment to satisfy my curiosity. The first time I was really made aware of your work was by my mother. I might have been a reaction to something that I was watching or listening that was maybe not so good. And she said, I got to show you some, you know, something proper. And she pulled up a performance that you did on Top of the Pops of Take Me to the River. And I had never seen anything like it in my life. I completely understood everything you were doing and the perfect mixture of what I like most about your work, the mixture of clarity and mystery. As I watched it over and over, which I then did, and this is such a niche question, I apologize, you don't blink for like a minute? And I've always wanted to know, was that showmanship?
Yes. Not human. Look, no blinking.
Well, it like not works. Human. It was the most amazing thing I've ever seen.
I'm not aware of that. I think at that point, I must have been fairly nervous and terrified at going on a show like that. I would imagine my movements were probably a little twitchy.
It was so cool. Twitchy.
Whatever, but it was fine. That's me. That's what I do.
Absolutely.
There's nothing to be ashamed of. That's just what I do.
Well, it worked on me. I was very taken by it.
Now I'm curious, what were you, do you remember what you were watching that your mom said?
I don't. Yeah, it might have been that, or it might have been that I was like, show me something cool. Mm-hmm. She would sort of show me cool things occasionally, but that was by far her biggest hit. It was her best success. Mm-hmm. In terms of showing me something. So, okay, that's good to know. Because it's a really long time that you don't blink. I was like, if that is showmanship, that's like there's one of the coolest, craziest things I've ever seen.
I'm not even aware of that.
Okay, good to know.
Well, like a lot of people, I became aware of your music ages ago. One of the things, I mean, I liked it very much immediately, but one of the things that struck me, I was listening to it, thinking how minimal it was. There was a lot going on in the vocal area with harmonies and all kinds of stuff. But musically, I thought, this is really stripped down. This is just what you need as far as the beats and keyboards and things that were there, and no more, which I completely knocked me out. I thought, wow. My impulse would be maybe to fill things up, but I thought, here's somebody who is kind of emptying things out and taking away everything that is, might not be needed, and it just song seems better for it. That was really, well, I don't know if I've been able to do that, but really, I thought, I can learn from that.
That's very nice of you. I appreciate it. I feel like I just... heard stuff on the radio and everything was so busy. My ear was so sensitive just didn't want any funny business. Mm-hmm. But you're right, I definitely in the vocal arrangement, I like to be really maximal. And I feel like I have gotten more maximal as I become a better producer.
Yes, but then you're more comfortable with it.
Yeah, but I sort of am feeling that mm-hmm. urge to push it all back again.
Did you get any pushback or in the beginning or saying, oh no, you need to add this and that and the other to this production?
You know, it's funny you say that. I released Royals on my mm-hmm. SoundCloud just for free mm-hmm. as part of an EP and sort of quickly got heard by a record company and kind of picked up an American record company. And they were like, well, you know, for the real version, like, you might need to put a bit more into it. And I was like, oh, uh-huh. This is the real magic. I think they thought, like, great demo, now we'll fill it full of
exactly.
stuff.
Exactly, yes.
And I think there were a few tries from people, and then everyone realized, like, you know, it's just what it is. And mm-hmm. I think if we had added a bunch of stuff to it, it would, like, still be on SoundCloud for free, you know? Uh-huh. Yeah.
So you felt... Right away, you had a sense of this is what this wants to be, not this.
Yeah. I mean, there's that Ira Glass quote that I've always really liked where he talks about being young and making stuff. You have taste, but you don't have skill. And so mm-hmm. you make things and you know they're not right, but your taste is intact and that will, you know, get you there eventually. Mm-hmm. So I feel like that was a big, you know, I would sort of bash through and try and make stuff. I can't really like play anything. I'm not a very good musician, mm-hmm. but I always had like my ear and just sort of knew what to keep away from it.
Okay, I have a question from your new album.
Oh yeah.
I'm jealous of songwriters who can really put specific things in a song. Like this one, might be the first or second song. You mentioned the Laurel Canyon Country Store. And because it's so specific, the place, the life, the culture around there, it kind of really kind of, just by naming that place, because I lived there in the mid 80s, oh. you kind of have an idea of, oh, I know what that's like. I know going down there for some groceries or pizza or whatever it was.
Yeah, good pizza.
Yeah, and that was, you if you were living in that area, so it paints a whole picture. And so can you think of other specifics or ones that you trying to think of ones like from other songs either that you've done or that other people have done? Sometimes people mention a street.
Yeah, I try to.
I try to, and it's very difficult for me.
Really?
I tend to write in generalities.
I guess that's true, actually, of your work. Yeah, I think Joni is the master of it.
Oh, geez, yeah.
She's that's like another level.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was always really cool to me. I'm sort of, I use specificity a lot because I like treating my work like a little map that is just for me, that I can put things in that really only have meaning to me, although sometimes mm-hmm. something like the Canyon Store, other people can understand, but it feels like a scrapbook or a map or something where I'm like, okay, I've pinned that butterfly to that board and that's for me. So that kind of is where that comes from, I guess. But I wish I could write more generally.
Was that a song about saying goodbye to that place?
Yeah, and yeah. just sort of...
And that life.
Wasn't really for me, yeah. Mm-hmm. But it was my first sort of stop off coming to America. Mm-hmm. I sort of got like swallowed into that for a bit and then was like, oh, no.
Very exciting. I remember for myself, yes, there were times I would get swallowed up in a kind of crazy life. Not too much, a little bit. And then... But there were times also where you out there, you get up in the morning and you could step outside. For people who ever live in New York, people in Los Angeles often have little gardens or a terrace or a patio, and you can step out and the sun is shining.
Yeah.
You can have your coffee outside.
Yeah.
Things like that. And it's kind of, you go, this is not bad. This is not bad. But then there's other things that are not so easy to deal with. Yeah, I found. Yes.
I've been collecting a lot of, every time I hear an interesting quote about California, I write it down because it's a place that I don't understand at all. But Norman Mailer called it a paradise without a vocabulary, which is like sort of the nightmare of way for someone to describe you, but somewhat accurate to parts of California, parts of Los Angeles, I think. I wanted to know, you strike me as someone with a big Rolodex in terms of like collaborators and friends who sort of make things, is that something that's important to you, or do you seek that out, or just hang back?
I seek it out a little bit. Sometimes it just happens. Mm. I'm sure it happens to you too. Sometimes I just get a call and say, oh, working on this, would you like to work on it together? Or maybe it might be a song for a film or something. Can you do this? And then they have specific needs. Mm-hmm. And we have an idea of what we're capable of and what our comfort zone is and where we've gone beyond. They're asking for something beyond what we're comfortable or able to do. I did one of those recently for a film by these two guys who are both named Daniel.
Okay.
It's directed by the Daniels.
Okay.
Yeah.
The Daniels. Is it out? Has it been released?
No, it's not out. I don't know when exactly it's coming out, but someone on the music team that I actually knew connected with a group in the American Midwest named Son Lux.
Oh, I love Son Lux. Yeah.
Yeah, I knew them a little bit. And they approached me and said, we're doing the score, but we want to do a song. And we're thinking that you and Mitski should do the song.
Oh, how cool.
And I said, yeah, I'm in.
That's amazing.
Yeah, so that was like in my comfort zone.
She's so great.
Yeah, I knew them a little bit, fan of hers. Mm-hmm. So I thought, okay, this is easy.
Oh, I can't wait to hear that. She came on tour with me actually last
week. Oh, really?
Yeah, and she gave me a great book by a theater director, I think. I want to say Peter Brook.
Oh, right. Yeah.
He which has some I should have known that very, her and you would
very
connect
broad,
somehow.
Kind of philosophical ideas about theater.
Yeah, that was a wild book.
And she has some amazing movement on stage.
Yes, very.
Not that I could do that, but
kissing that hand. Have you seen that one?
Yes.
I kind of wish I'd thought of that.
Very good.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
When you're doing a show, you begin with, these are the songs I think I'm going to do. What do I want to say visually? What do I want to say with movements or sets or whatever? How do you break it down?
Well, I am pretty conceptual, I will say, somewhat embarrassingly. So it's often kind of whatever songs I choose and how is in service of this, like, mm-hmm. you know, the more of the umbrella. But it's tricky when you only have, like, I have had two albums out. I will have three out mm-hmm. by the time this comes out. It's not much to draw from. And yeah. I remember on my first album, you would just play the whole album and then a couple of covers.
We're done.
And yeah, you just didn't have anything else. Yeah. But it's nice to have that little bit more.
But now, there'll be a lot to choose from. So,
but it's, yeah, it's
but
a
you said
it's
very
show.
Conceptual, but then the conceptual is going to be balanced by the songs, which are very emotional.
Yeah.
So that kind of balances off any of the.
Yeah. It'll be interesting doing this one because it's definitely its own thing. I don't know yet how it will kind of mesh with the other stuff. But I guess in the context of your shows, I mean, it's time for a confession here. And there's a real meaning to this. I have very willfully not seen American Utopia because I wanted to see it in the flesh.
Well,
it's very important to me to see it in the flesh.
We'll be in town. We'll be back soon.
But here's the thing: we've had this planned, and sort of every day I've thought, should I watch it on the computer? I'm gonna wait. Maybe I should watch it on the computer. I'm gonna wait. And I did it right up to last night. And I was like, no, I'm going to wait because I just really want to see it in person. So I can't fully ask you about it. But, you know, I guess I have experienced you sort of combining songs from records within a show mm-hmm. in a way that works very well. Is that easy for you to do? You don't mind sort of putting them all together?
I don't mind. I know I've learned that you do have to play some of the hits for the audience. I've learned that the hard way.
Did you used to not play something?
There was one tour where I had a reason for it. I started working with a very large Latin band, and I've done a record like that. Mm-hmm. And there were a few of older songs that I could work in there, but a lot of them really didn't fit that musical style.
Totally.
So I was doing, you know, 80% new stuff that the audience had never heard. And the audience had a good time, but I realized, I think they really would have liked to have heard a few of the songs they were familiar with. It's just something that in our business where, unlike, it always puzzles me, unlike, say, a movie or a play, you're not expected to like, well, you know, do that scene that you did in the one before that we really like. Can you kind of just repeat that again?
Yeah. True, that's a funny way of thinking about it.
But
the big scene.
But it's also true that music has a different thing. Music is repeatable that way.
Yeah.
It can move people again.
And you can recontextualize it.
Yes, which is fun to do. Mm. So as you were describing, yes, I start with a very kind of conceptual frame, whether it's the staging or what the band is going to be, how we're going to present ourselves. And then I feel like the emotion kind of takes care of itself in a way. Huh. It kind of comes through. I don't have to do it, but I do, as you said, enlist a choreographer. I worked with a kind of a director who acted as a dramaturg, looking at kind of how a kind of story was being told through the songs. Mm-hmm. Beginning to end, saying, I think maybe you should move this one up here, maybe move that one, and it helps the kind of story arc, even though it's not a kind of complete biographical story. Mm-hmm. There was a kind of progression. So yes, I learned a little bit about that, little by little, and also learned that I don't know when it works until you put it in front of an audience.
Right, for sure.
You can't tell if they're getting it until you can see that they're getting it.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. And things that you think.
Yeah, think, oh, that's a great idea. Yeah. They're going to love that. And then nothing.
Well, I'm very excited to see it properly the way. I mean, I obviously know and have heard that both versions are very worth seeing and in the, together in that you see a lot that you would not see as an audience member through the
That's true.
But I just, there was an order that I felt important to me to go in. So if you'll have me, I'll
looking forward to seeing you there.
I wanted to ask again about sort of that relationship between clarity and mystery in your work, because I remember as a teenager, I was friends with a lot of kids who I guess would go on to go to art school. Mm-hmm. And they liked what they liked and they wanted me to like it. And some of it I would try and not be able to understand, sort of push through the like polyphonic intricacies perhaps. Mm-hmm. And I realized later that wasn't really my failing or anyone's failing, but it's to do with how clarity and mystery are being mm-hmm. used and when to deploy and when there maybe needs to be a sprinkle more of one or the other.
This was music that they were?
Yeah, I guess so.
This is not drawings or paintings.
No, it's really only music
I'm a fan of this and you need to know about this.
Yeah, and I would just try so hard and it would break my brain. But then like, obviously I saw your work and was like, oh, this has the, that mystery that I love and that clarity that I need, you know. And I wanted to know, like, do you lean towards one or the other? Do you know when it's right to go to one or just sort of learn?
Yeah, I think I default to more ambiguous kind of abstract lyrics that are more generalizations. Mm. But my dream is to get more specifics mixed in there to kind of ground it in a place or time or whatever. I realized I love a song that's all questions, but I don't write too many of them, but I have collections of possible lyrics.
Wow.
Things that I've read in a book or somewhere else, and I go, oh, look, what a nice series of questions.
I love a question in a song.
Yeah.
Cool thing.
I read one the other day that said something like, is this the real me or am I putting on a performance? And if I'm putting on a performance, are you putting on a performance too? And what if you put on my performance and I put on your performance? And I went on like this, a series of questions that kind of went down
that's
a rabbit
amazing.
Hole.
That's cool, I like that. But you're so good with a, like what I think of as a pop melody.
Thank you.
Have you always sort of been drawn to, or has that been something that's been easy to access for you as a songwriter? The more primary colored sort of.
I always liked, I had no say fear of a pop melody or being accessible. I thought it was always fine. I don't know if I don't think in the beginning I was able to do it. I think
you were.
Well, thank you. I've listened to earlier things and I feel like I sound like a little bit desperate trying to get across, which maybe is a good thing too.
Interesting.
And then I remember, probably like a lot of people, buying these songbooks from different artists, songwriters, just kind of learning the songs. Sometimes things I didn't even really care for that much, but I thought, let's see how this is done. Let me learn to play this on a guitar and sing along just for myself. And I think through that, I would learn, look, you can go from this chord to that chord and it'll take the melody somewhere there, which is has this kind of emotional lift to it right there. Ooh, I should remember that. And yeah, sure enough, you have to be careful that it doesn't become a thing that you keep going back to.
David's chords.
Yeah. It sounds like one of yours. Yeah.
Interesting.
But yes, I feel like I've learned that a little bit.
The same part of you that says hello to people.
Yes, but I've learned that, at least in my opinion, there's nothing wrong with a song sounding beautiful. You can actually say something quite profound, something kind of radical or even, but it can sound in the melody or in the way it's sung or whatever, it can sound quite beautiful, and yet it can be something that conveys a really radical idea. And I thought, oh yeah, but it can sound very kind of beautiful and seductive on the surface, and then it sucks you into something where it might really change your way of thinking.
That's interesting. So you were sort of, there was a time when you were not wanting things to sound beautiful. That was something you
avoided. Yes, there was a time where I thought things have to be edgy and whatever, which is, that's all good.
Yeah.
But I was maybe afraid that if things sounded too beautiful or pretty, then they were shallow.
Yeah, that's interesting.
It's necessary. It was probably, oh, this is shallow. This is like a greeting card. This is
whatever.
And you can't be saying anything serious this way. But then I heard other songwriters doing that where I thought, no, they're saying something really, really deep and important. Mm. And yet the song is really beautiful or nice to listen to. And I thought, okay, it can be done.
Yeah. I think of beauty as a real like tenet of your work for sure.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. What do you do for stage fright?
I really don't have a good answer for that. And it's a real problem that I'm trying to get on top of. I take little notes to the stage for myself. So I'll go over to an area and be able to read something that me from the past is trying to tell me from the future. Mm-hmm, and I feel very like, I'm like, okay, she's here. And she's here. It's
right.
But it's a real struggle. There's like a homeopathic product called Rescue Remedy.
I know that stuff.
So I've been known to sort of hit the dropper side of stage, but it's just something that that lives in my body that I need to figure out how to exercise.
Does it help if you have things more or less mapped out? If there's less.
No, that does not help. Nothing really. It's like a total mystery to me what it really is or where it comes from. But it's like very real. But ever since I was a kid, I would do, speech competitions and school plays. And
right,
and you would bubble up,
So the same thing. Yeah, but so you were terrified, but yet you would do these things.
Yeah, like I knew I had to.
I felt that.
Do it
when I was younger. Yes, I felt. I felt very socially uncomfortable. Mm. And yet, as you say, I would throw myself on a stage and do a speech of some sort, or I would perform something crazy and realize, and then retreat back into myself.
But now you can, it's, there's no sizzle before you go on stage, no little.
There is a little bit, but not the, it's not the same.
Okay.
And it's.
You're not like, someone get me, like maybe I could get out that door and run down the street.
And get away from here.
Get away from here. Because that does come to me occasionally. I'm like, maybe the car could just go around the block for 4 hours and then I'd miss the show. I'm always glad I did it. Yeah. It's pretty precious, but it's tricky.
No, I haven't thought that in a while.
It's good to know. I wanted to know, it's something that I think about, and it's this idea of portals, like in your work. Can you think of like any time a portal opened up, whether it was like meeting someone or making something where you were like, oh, this is it, this is the next sort of dimension of what I'm doing? It's kind of a weird question, but I wonder what your portals would be like.
I've gone through a lot of different things. I went from, like with Talking Heads, being a three-piece to a four-piece, that little bit of a change, and then going to a nine-piece, that was a radical change.
Mm.
It felt different musically and on stage.
Mm-hmm.
I went then with, as I said, working with a pretty large Latin band, and that felt different. Emotionally, it felt a bit like where Talking Heads had been, where it feels like you were really part of this community and they were kind of supporting you, and everybody was supporting one another. And then I went through a period of learning to write a little, what I felt were a little bit more beautiful songs once in a while.
When was that, do you think? When did your beautiful songs?
Something like that. I think it was after that. I've done now, I think, two new stage musicals.
Mm-hmm.
That was a very different way of working.
Mm-hmm.
It was the thing where the writing has to tell a specific story from a specific character's point of view. So I had to learn how to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Luckily, I kind of had been doing that all along, writing from a character's point of view.
Right.
So it wasn't that hard, but it just had to be a little bit more specific.
Mm-hmm.
And now I don't know, we'll see.
Yeah, interesting. When you first did, when you did Stop Making Sense, did you feel like, oh, this is like a really vivid arm of what I'm supposed to do, making the show in that way?
Yeah.
You knew
I was kind of aware that this is a kind of a radical idea.
Mm-hmm.
And oh, it worked.
Mm-hmm.
People like it.
Mm-hmm.
They like the songs, mm-hmm. the band, the show. And so I thought, oh, we should film this. Maybe it's justified filming it because it kind of has an arc, a beginning and a middle,
of course,
and an end.
Yeah.
It's not just one song after another. And so, yeah, I was aware that we kind of had something.
Yeah. Good.
I didn't like to get too, big ahead about it, but I felt like, I do think we have something here.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. How many times had you done that show before you filmed it? Was that sort of at the
a
end
lot.
Of the...
I mean, we've done a whole tour. I forget how long it went.
Mm.
I don't know.
I could tell the muscles were really honed. You know, that end of tour.
Yeah.
It was done at the end.
And it was kind of like, okay, we know everything we're supposed to be doing here in every moment.
Yeah.
It kind of emerged out of spontaneous stuff, but then it became that thing with your head works really well at that point.
Mm-hmm. That's so cool. I mean, I think of you as someone who's very plugged in to sort of the greater culture and all things kind of social, I suppose. I wanted to know if you enjoy this portal or if you feel beholden to it, or like what your relationship is like to.
Okay.
Might be too personal.
No, it's not personal at all. I'm not on social media, but I have a little office.
Yeah, I see some little photos.
Yeah, they post
I looked you up. I'm not on either, but I looked you up.
They post my photos, mm-hmm. and I said, just post my photos and we'll leave it at that.
Oh, that's nice.
But I'm not checking things. So I realized when social media started emerged, I thought, I think I have enough to do rather than feeding this. Mm. I was more about concern about my workload than concern about what it might, other effects it might have, which we've all heard from different people, the other effects of that can have.
The workload is a very real concern.
But yes, I just kind of...
That was a good
suddenly
way.
I've got another job.
Yeah.
I've got to feed this beast.
Okay.
And I realized, no, I didn't want to do that. So that said, I think I get up every morning and I have my grapefruit and my coffee and I read at least two newspapers mm-hmm. online. Mm-hmm. So I'm kind of... for that time, for that hour, kind of a news junkie, which I eventually realized, this is not making me well. This is
the news.
Yeah, the news is not making me well. Yeah. I need an antidote to this.
Uh-huh.
I realized, oh, this is, it's really easy to get addicted to this, to get sucked into kind of checking this all the time, that kind of thing. So,
what was your antidote to all the news?
I started working with started doing it myself, and then started working with friends on this journalism project called Reasons to be Cheerful. And we looked for instances, news of people finding solutions to problems as opposed to the problems themselves, which are certainly out there. But we hear about those all the time.
Mm.
So that, and I realized, I hear, let's say, about music. I hear about it a little bit from publications, but also a lot from friends.
Yeah.
A lot of times friends will send me, oh, have you heard this? And that'll lead me to that and then to something else, and next thing you know, yes, I've added a whole lot of things to my playlist, which is great.
Yeah.
Which is great.
Interesting, that sounds like a very healthy way of
So far it's kind of manageable.
Yeah. I like the grapefruit too, that's a nice, a nice way to start the morning. It's,
again, yes.
Do you have the little spoon with the edge?
The pointy edge? We're getting very personal here. I just peel it with my hands.
Whoa, that's crazy, David.
Then rip it.
First thing in the morning, you're peeling a grapefruit?
With my hands and then rip it in half.
You're segmenting? Rip it in half?
Yeah, then I rip it. Yeah, take the skin off, then rip it in half. And then I only eat half of it. And I always have like a napkin or towel because it's just... some bits drip.
I've never peeled a grapefruit. That's wild.
Not that hard to do.
Okay, you heard it first, people. That's
yes.
A scoop from today.
What about you? Where do you get your information then? From friends, mainly from friends? Talking with friends?
Well, we were speaking before about I've sort of tried to make my phone like less of an... a portal, so I can't, you know, go on any apps or do any searches, but I have the news also. So I do that, and I actually find out about a lot of new things from the, like, newspaper on my phone, almost more than I would probably from Twitter or something, but I miss a lot, and that was something that I had to really become okay with, because as a a teenager and then a sort of late adolescent, really got like all the fingers on all the pulses, and you know about every little subgenre and undercurrent. And in choosing to sort of step back a bit, I had to relinquish some of that power, which is very difficult.
I'm aware that there's things that happen here. There were protest marches and things like that that I would hear about from a friend and say, oh, everybody's going to meet here and here. And I go, how'd you know about that? Oh, social media. And I go, oh, that's some of the stuff I'm missing.
Yes. No, totally. I had the same experience with that. But that I think was a good, I feel like if you had good friends, they would tell you.
Yeah.
You'd get to the right spot on that. But yeah, it is. I mean, it's tricky. I try not to... get too bogged down. It's funny, I'm living in the city at the moment, and I slept for the first night in this new house and it was so, so loud. And so
oh,
I
new
was
New York is loud.
Crazy. Crazy.
Sorry.
So I was given this white noise machine.
Did it work?
It's incredible, but you push the little things and it does like a babbling brook, a gently pattering rainfall, like a thunderstorm, you know, birds tweeting. And it's pretty funny to have made this work about like the environment and technology and then be like lulled to sleep by the babbling brook coming out of the white noise machine. I was like,
It can be a real thing. I think I have double pane windows. So
I need to
still
get that.
Hear an ambulance or
a
loud car going by, but the general noise can be shut out. But New York is.
I got to take care of that business.
Yes, and it becomes a mental thing where you start to be able to, even though it's all there, you start to be able to shut it out little by little. And the only thing that will wake you is if, say, your partner calls your name or something like that. That you go, oh, that's me.
I yearn for that day. A true New Yorker. I mean, I may have already sort of asked this, but I want to know what your favorite non-music thing that you get to do is. And are any of them preferred to making music? Is making music still your favorite thing that you do? Or has anything surpassed it?
No, nothing surpassed it, but I find that over the years I do different things. I do this journalism thing, so I occasionally get to research and write an article, which I really enjoy, but I don't do it every day. I don't have to churn, I'm not obliged to churn them out, but I try and do it as much as I can. During the pandemic, I started doing drawings, which might have been a kind of therapy, maybe.
Yeah, maybe.
probably like a lot of people, I spent a lot of time cooking during the
pandemic. That was another question I wanted to.
A lot of time cooking.
We talked about.
I learned some other things, some things, yes. Oh, yeah.
Are you really into food or cooking?
I'm not super fussy, but I think it's underappreciated as a kind of creative art form.
I completely agree.
I think I realized that once you learn from a recipe, let's say, how to make something, you can sort of then start to improvise. You can learn to substitute one sour thing for another sour thing.
Mm.
And that kind of changes it a little bit, but it keeps the balance of what's going on there. And you can kind of, well, it's kind of like music that way.
Mm.
You know that, okay, you need something here, but what is it? Try this. Then you can,
That's nice. I like that. It's a good way of putting it as
and
a creative
kind
art.
Of like music, you maybe not so much during the pandemic when I ended up with a lot of frozen leftovers, but and other times then you get to offer it to friends and say, what do you think of this? What about this?
Yeah, it's real alchemy in that way, like sharing. I feel it like almost more with food than with music, like the effect of what I've made on people, you know? I guess you're like,
they react right away.
Watching.
Anything you learned to cook in the last year and a half?
I mean, I cook a lot. I'm trying to think of something I really started making in the pandemic. I'm not really a good recipe cook. I just sort of do whatever I'm going to do. But I feel like I made some really good condiments. I like making like a big...
Condiments? You mean like chutneys and things
like
that?
Yeah, like a chutney, a jam, a little, some sort of savory little... Something, you know, I like to jar things up and send them on to my friends.
Oh, that's good. That's nice for your friends.
Yeah. I wanted to know if you have any sort of like little things that you do before you perform or any ways of kind of snapping into that mode at all.
I don't have much of a ritual. That kind of thing. I keep myself busy. I make some ginger tea. I'll peel the ginger, slice it, put it into a thermos, put boiling water in with there's some lemon or whatever else. And that'll keep me busy for a good 15, 20 minutes. And then I've got to let that steep and cook. And I'll do things like
You've
that.
You've done some fiddling.
Do some little fiddling. And things like that. Keep my mind a little bit away from what I'm about to do until, you know, you'll get a call. Okay, 5 minutes. Yeah.
I like that. That's nice. Yeah, you do need a little fiddle. I do a lot of puzzles on tour. I'm often like applying a, you know, piece right when it's time to go, which maybe doesn't help the stage fright. Like that's a too much of a change of mode. You know, I'm like still looking for the puzzle at the first song. Is there anything that you, looking back, that you would be like, if I could impart that bit of wisdom, I would, to someone else?
That's a really tough one.
There might not be an answer.
It's really tough because sometimes I might think that I have some wisdom that I should impart to somebody else because you need to know this or whatever. But I also feel like, who are you to be telling other people? Like, so I often pull back and kind of go, feel like, who are you to presume that you know better than someone else?
Yeah.
Better that they discover it by either seeing what you're doing for themselves, but then rather than you telling them.
Yeah, that's fair.
Which is can be a bit of a school teacher-y thing.
Yeah.
I'm trying to avoid that.
Okay, good to know.